Welcome to another episode of the Becky Choice podcast shows. And today we will dive into diastasis recta healing journey. How long does it actually take to heal your diastasis? So I wanted to dissect my journey, my diastasis journey with you in this episode, really dissect every single thing that I've done and that led to where I am at right now. And I'm not saying that I don't have belly. I still have a belly. I don't have flat abs. But I wanted to just walk you through and re-dissect everything I have done, maybe what I could have done better. And also with over 150 clients that I work with now worldwide, I wanted to just share with you some of the findings, some of the lessons learned from working with these clients and helping them to healing their diastasis. I wanted to share with you what has worked well and what could have done better or differently. So if you're interested to learning or knowing more about how long it will take for you to heal your DR, then this episode is definitely for you. So now let's talk about my diastasis journey, and everything I'm talking and referencing here is really mainly based on my own journey and the clients that I have helped, about 150 clients that I have helped, and also all the educations that I have taken over the last couple of years in fitness, postnatal fitness, and especially for diastasis recti. So combining with these knowledge and my own experience and making myself that guinea pig to try everything, I wanted to share with you what I think for healing your journey. And this is not like a diagnostic thing for you. This is not a medical plan for you. So don't take my advice unless you seek your medical doctor or your physician before you start anything. All right. All right. So if we are going to dissect into the journey, I think we have to go back to almost 5 years ago. I just gave birth to my first baby, Jordan, and I delivered him at home. Really, really tough labor. I pushed him over 2.5 hours, couldn't make it to the hospital because my water broke. And right after my water broke, I feel like I needed to push him. And the reason why it took me 2.5 hours to push, because he was on an angle. And I think if they were to send me on like an ambulance, if I were able to go to the hospital, I probably would have had a emergency C-sections. But I didn't, because I was giving birth, giving him on my bed, in my bedroom. Yeah, and luckily my midwife came on time and they helped me. But yeah, with the pushing phase was absolutely horrendous. My mom was with me at that time, my husband was too, and they were petrified. They were horrified by the experience. I'm like, I need to push him out. Like, so okay, so that's a little bit of a side story about my labor. Wasn't that smooth and sailing, like it wasn't a C-sections where, you know, I don't feel the pain. It was a really, really hard. And I have like a third degree tear down there, and the stitches was painful. Oh my goodness. And a little bit TMI here, and like right after I gave birth, I peed on my bed. Like I just couldn't hold it. There was no muscles. But anyways, so I wanted to dissect the journey. So right after I gave birth, in Chinese culture, so we have what's called the confinement. So what happened is, like, within the first month, the mom is not allowed to go anywhere. She's not allowed to step out of the house, not even the room. You're supposed to be on your bed most of the time. You don't want to move your body too much. You wanted to let it heal as much as you can and breastfeed the baby. And pretty much they would deliver the food, and like my mom would make the food and deliver the food to my bedroom. And I just sleep and eat and sleep and eat, basically, at least for the first 2 weeks. And it was a really tough labor for me. So I actually couldn't really do too much anyways. I was really weak down there. And like, I was just feeling very heavy if I walk too much. Like, it just really feel very uncomfortable for me down there. So I lay down anyways a lot of time. And so for 2 weeks, probably I was in my bedroom with my baby, and maybe my husband would carry him around. I would just walk around in the bedroom. And then maybe the third week, I actually go outside to my condo at that time, the living room, to eat dinner with my mom and my husband. That was like the first time I got out of the bedroom. I still remember that. But so it's a usual thing in the Chinese culture that you shouldn't be doing too much in the first month to heal your body, to get the breast milk out. So then the baby is eating enough and you're resting enough, and you're producing enough milk, essentially. That's the idea. And then keeping you warm. So it's like it's called the roasting, mother roasting. So like, you're keeping yourself warm, and then you will also heal faster because your blood is circulating better and you'll feel better. So with that first month or even the second month, I really didn't care how my body looked. Yeah, I felt like something was really off, like my belly was really big, and I truly thought that's how it's supposed to look after pregnancy. And you know, the midwife would come and check me at around 6 weeks postpartum or 7 weeks postpartum. That was the last checkup, and I went to her office. That was probably the first time I stepped out of the condo, other than maybe like a short walk, like literally like a block at around my condo. But that was actually the first time I step out and go somewhere, is to visit her in her office. And you know, they just check your uterus and see if they shrink in place and if there's something wrong, something else. Like, but they don't talk about anything about the belly or anything about diastasis at all. Like, I've never heard of that term. And then just maybe like around 3 months postpartum, 2.5 months postpartum, and then I was wondering, why is my belly still sticking out so much? I literally, if you're listening to the episode and you've never saw my before picture, I literally look like a penguin. I have my head, and then like I have like a triangle shape, right? My belly is protruding, and I had this huge belly. Probably the waist was around 37 inches, 38 inches. And I'm a skinny, typical type of Asian girl. Like, it's, weight was never my problem. So that was my first time gaining that much weight. Like, at birth, I was 160 something. And after birth, I was 145, and that didn't drop. And so I thought, wow, that's like the belly fat, right? That's around my, oh, it's all stuck on my belly. And so, but then I saw my friend. So at around 3 months postpartum, I saw my friend who gave birth just around the same time as I had, and she looks amazing. Like, she would fit into her dress perfectly. I don't even see her belly. And I had a really hard time finding something for myself to wear that night. I remember going to her 100th day party, and I had really hard time finding something that would hide my belly but doesn't look too shaggy, you know, with celebrating, right, 100 day. And so then I look at her, I'm like, this doesn't seem very normal. So I just was getting fed up with myself. And so I started my journey on fitness. Like, I have no idea where to start, but my husband kind of introduced me to do this at-home fitness program, and I didn't have to go anywhere because I have never been to the gym, and I didn't have time neither. Like, my baby was always very needy. Jordan was always on my boobs. So I just started my journey. You know, those are one of those typical cardio types, HIIT style type of workouts, at home workout program. So it lasts about 12 to 14 weeks or so. You know, I mean, I feel great while doing the workout. I sweat and I can feel like I gain lots of strength. I feel stronger in my body. However, I always wonder why my belly was sticking out so much, especially when I was doing plank, especially when I am, you know, one of those traditional ab workouts, maybe doing like a Russian twist or like a leg lift. I was wondering why my belly was protruding, and I still didn't know that I had DR at that time. And I really should have asked, and you know, to get myself educated about this, but I didn't, and that was stupid for me. But what I can tell you from that experience, even though I lost 22 pounds after about 3 months, yes, I look better, I feel better, but that belly still looked pretty big. And I am more than sure, even though I didn't know I have DR, but I'm more than sure whatever I did has worsened the situations. Because now that I look back 3 years later, now I look, 5 years later, now I look back, I really realize that unintentionally worsened the situations, worsened my diastasis to a point that is probably irreversible for now. Because I pushed myself, I thought, okay, if I just have to do a couple more planks, hold it for a little longer, if I just do a couple more leg lift and, you know, bend a certain way, I would look better. I had no clue, you know, I didn't have fitness background. So I kept pushing myself, and I think that push did it to me. Like, I had back pain, I have some leaking issues. Internally, it doesn't feel too good. Externally wise, I lost that way, yes, I feel better. Maybe look better, so it makes me feel better. But internally, there was still some issues there. And so, like, so that's when I, you know, went around a circle, and it was not a lot until a lot later that I found out I have DR. Then shortly after that, I was pregnant again. So what I wanted to share with you with this experience, that with me going into a total body fitness program without knowing that I had a DR, keep pushing myself and keep doing without having a foundation in place, was actually a really dangerous. It could be dangerous for sure. And now that I think back, you know, if I kept pushing, if I continue to do even maybe a few more reps, who knows, maybe I would have developed a hernia because I keep pushing. If that weakened muscle, so weakened muscles in the core is so weak, I could push myself to having a hernia. I could even push myself to having a prolapse, a uterine prolapse. Luckily, that didn't happen. But now I think back, I was just doing too much. Now, and then after the second pregnancy, after having Emily, I was careful now this time because I just right before I was pregnant, the second time I found out I have DR. So the second time I was careful. Even though, yes, the first one I did the confinement again, I didn't, you know, have to care too much. I mean, you know, if you have two kids now, it's just hard to take care of yourself, let alone like you want to sleep first than anything. And so, but at 6 weeks postpartum, I did go check out with a physiotherapist in my local area. And also she finally diagnosed or like noted that I had that DR. And I filmed a short clip videos of that the second time that I went. But that the very first time I went, I didn't. But she did say that I had about 4.5 fingers wide diastasis. That she did not tell me, but on the second visit, I filmed a video when she checked me. Even though she didn't tell me how many depth of the fingers she could insert into my gap, I could see from the video that she was able to insert two knuckles and even more into that gap. So now, later on, then I knew that it was that deep, 4.5 fingers, 2 knuckles. Now, what did I do? So she taught me to do some engagement exercise, like Kegels. Imagine your hip bones are drawing in together. She did tell me some like lighter exercises, a scarf exercise. It was one that she taught me that I also share if you're on my email list, on my Instagram. It's a scarf exercise. Basically, you're using a scarf and you should be wearing a belly wrap and you wear a scarf and manually bring the external six packs together. So you would lie on your back, do a mini crunch, and then you would tie the scarf around the belly area and then pull on either side, and as you lift your head up, you would pull that scarf on either end and then pull away, and then that will bring the belly together, right? It's like a corset. So I did that for a few weeks, and you know, every week I would go back, or every 2 weeks I went back to her for a checkup, and she say, oh no, you know, you're improving, you're doing well. But the thing is that I still look pregnant. Like internally she said I had improvement, good, but I was just really not happy with my weight. And then so I think back to, you know, what I did with my first pregnancy. So I did the total body workout. You know what? I could try doing it again because I lost 22 pounds. And maybe because it was these kind of technique, the engagement technique I didn't have properly. Maybe I just need to be more mindful and modify it better this time. So that's what I thought. And so that's why I started doing a total body workout again, because I could not stand the way I looked. And I was like 140 something pounds again. I was just like a penguin, couldn't fit anything. And it was just really upsetting for me. I think for any mom, you see yourself like that in the mirror, it really crushes you. You know, you have all your clothes hanging in your closets. It's really, really, really bad feeling. And I, as much as I try to be optimistic, and you know, when I saw a picture of myself on the phone, like see how I actually looked, you know, it really crushes anybody. It really messes you. So I jumped into the program, but I was really mindful this time, and I'm really happy with the result. I lost a ton of weight. I lost 35 pounds in about 5 months. And that gap seems to heal really nicely, because every time I go back to check with my physiotherapist, she say, wow, you're doing really well, you're doing really well, and you're doing really well. So I trusted her. And then I didn't realize when I am engaging my core and when I am flexing my stomach, it all looks pretty good. Like it all looks like everything is contained, everything is wrapped up, like my belly looks kind of flat. Then I became skinny and have some muscles at that time. So that was 5 months to a year later. I was still training, doing programs, and then I got a lot stronger and I was really happy. But you know, when you're totally relaxed, that belly just kind of protrude out. And then so I was pondering for a really long time. So did I actually do something wrong? Like, did I actually do something wrong to myself? Like, this was really frustrating. 1.5 years later, after giving birth to my second baby, Emily, 1.5 years later, I still have that belly. so frustrating at how I had lost all the weight. Over a year now, I didn't have to lose anymore. I was just focusing on maintaining and just building some muscles. You know, I've been consistent with my workout and I was really mindful of my food choices. I don't go crazy, but I don't restrict myself neither. The belly still feel like a jello to me, you know? Like, yes, when I'm flexed, when I am engaging my core, yeah, it could look okay. But when I'm totally relaxed, it's just like a saggy belly, like it sags, and it's like when I'm bloated too, especially, it's bloated and also looks, it's jello-y. You know what I'm saying? If you're listening to this. So like, then I was like wondering, like, why is this so hard, right? I've seen other ladies who gave birth and they get good results after just 8 weeks and sometimes for 6 weeks, and they have like feel like they went back in shape, just snapped back in shape. Like, what's wrong with me, right? So I want you to understand that in research shows, every single woman who have come to a full term, it give birth 37 weeks postpartum and pregnancy and beyond, and they gave birth, 100% would have diastasis recti, and 2/3 of them will still have diastasis at 3 months postpartum, and at 1 year postpartum, 1/3 of them will still have it. This is from research. Now, a lot of the moms, they at 6 weeks postpartum, and you can see from this research too, it's like they just spontaneously be able to go back in shape, be able to go back into their pre-baby shape like they have never had baby before. But for others, for 1/3 of those mom and or 2/3 of those moms, this will not happen unless they intervene, unless they exercise, unless they do nutritions. So then, yeah, then I'm comparing myself to these ladies, like, wow, 8 weeks she's able to go back. Wow, 6 weeks, oh my gosh, what am I doing? Like, it's been 1.5 years, that's 78 weeks. Did I do something wrong? Then I really ponder and wonder to myself, like, I recalled every single details of my journey, you know, how I found out, how I got checked, and, you know, it was a lot of sweat and tears during my journey to keep it off and be able to lose that weight. And I think one of the conclusion at that time I came to this is that there were just so many things you don't know, and there's only so many things that you can do. You don't know what you don't know. It's like having a baby, right? Only if having a baby comes with a manual. There won't be so many sleepless nights. Won't be so many painful breastfeeding sessions. And not to mention diastasis recti is such an underspoken topic. Really remains a mystery to many of us, and there just have not been too many research done about this, not recently. And because you can hear from my story, and I'm sure you can relate it too, if you went to your doctor or your OB for the checkup, they don't talk about the diastasis. And then so most of us only know about DR because they researched about it online. Maybe they know there's something wrong like I did, and then so they were never aware of this. So at that time, that was like about 1.5 years after I gave birth. So 1.5 years ago. So I have to steer myself from what I have been used to doing, total body workout. I really wanted to focus on something very specific to diastasis specific workout. And so before I share with you about doing diastasis workout, I wanted to just share some of the undeniable facts when I combining doing total body workout and having a foundations in place. And for me at that time, the knowledge of foundation is really just in being able to engage my core. I was in the best shapes, and I would say so, except for that belly, but I was in the best shape. I was strong. I was the strongest I've ever been. I had definition overall in my body. I was not experiencing any back pain. I was not leaking anymore. And I did have a lot of energy. And my mind was clear. I was not in a fog. So I felt really good. And that's why I preach what I teach. And I teach my clients to do total body workout. And even if you don't have diastasis. But what I did differently at that time, 1.5 years ago, is then I really started profoundly researching and following my mentors of physical therapists to really study about this topic in depth. I took certification courses, corrective exercises, diastasis evidence-based diastasis exercise. I learned from experts. So then I learned a lot about that you have to challenge yourself. So you have to challenge yourself, you breathe better, you have to align yourself better. Posture is a huge thing. And what I think with my belly was that the total body workout just not targeted enough, right? They are amazing workout. They help me sculpt my leg. My legs are strong. They help me sculpt my shoulders, my arms. I have obliques. It helps to pull my tummy in, and that's why you would see a flatter stomach on my pictures or, you know, when I'm engaging. But those exercises were just too general for the overall body. It was not targeted enough for the transverse abdominal muscles, which is the deep core muscles that really we need to work on. And for some moms, you just need a lot of attention to work on the deep core muscles, going back to the basic instead of going too much on the total body workout. While that's still really important, I preach it, but we need to lay the really strong foundation in place first, and that is to work on the posture, the alignment. Usually we have a high hinge point, like the back of your spine, it's on a really curve, like have a really C-shaped curvature after pregnancy, because you were used to having that kind of belly in front of you, so your back is on a curved. Your hip is tight, like the pelvis is tight. You don't have that kind of mobility to move around. That's why you might experience lower back pain, hip pain. There was a ribs and back expansion while breathing. The ribs are stuck. They're not moving. When you're breathing, your ribs are supposed to be moving too. And then also like your obliques my obliques were overly dominant because the deep core muscles just won't fire. And, you know, I wasn't working on them too much. So my obliques and my upper abdominal muscles, they were generally the one that's going to help me pull in. And so they were overly dominant. And that makes the TA, the transverse abdominal muscles, under firing. So I finally learned about that and I gave myself some time and trusted the process. So I did that religiously for a few months, 3-4 months, and even like 6-7 months, I was doing it consistently. And then, you know, like I feel the strength in the deep core muscles, and I can feel that the depth was finally less squishy. The gap was always, you know, closing into like one-ish finger, but it was less squishy than before, but it is still pretty squishy. And I think a lot of that has to come from the stretch skin, the loose skin that I had, and the total abdominal profile. And what that means is when you're pregnant, your entire belly expand out. It's not just the linea alba. So the linea alba is where it's right, it's a midline vertically from your sternum to your pelvis. It's attaching your left and right core muscles together, so it's like the midline there. And a lot of us think, and like technically, maybe you're not as technical as us, but like that linea alba, we focus too much on that linea alba to bring them closer together, to make it less squishy. Because when you're feeling the depth, you're feeling the linea alba. And we focus too much on that. But what happens is when you're pregnant, your total profile, they just expand out so, so much. And it's not just the linea alba anymore, it's your entire core that is so stretched out. It's so stretched out to the point that it really loses that elasticity. So imagining you have an elastic band, you stretched it continuously for 9 months or even the last 3 months of your third trimester, and you stretch it so much, now it's deflated. It loses that elasticity. And for some moms like myself, it's just really, really hard to restore that layers of muscles. While some muscle might be able to help you pull in everything together, like the obliques muscles, maybe the upper abdominal muscles, but there's still weakness of the abdominal core. And it's just that it would just be really hard to bring that in to flat, even when you're on a resting tone, like totally relaxed. So I really wish that somebody would have taught me about posture, alignment, the form of those exercises, how to engage, how to breathe. I really wish somebody would have taught me that before I started the program. I feel like that would have made such a big difference in terms of how my core is now. And then so I wasn't giving up. Honestly, I was like, I wanted to see some definition on my core. I wanted to see my belly flatter, even when I'm totally resting and totally relaxed. Like, what else can I do? So I worked on nutrition. I work on like a stricter nutrition plan, especially for bloating. and also work on some hardcore exercise, a lot harder core exercises, because you need to progressively load your core beyond your muscles can handle. So it's just like your bicep muscles, right? If you're lifting 3 pounds over and over again, it's not going to help you build up muscles. So you need to progressively load more. And for our core, you just have to do harder exercise. But just before we touch point on the exercise part, I wanted to just touch point on the nutrition. Now, bloating is a huge issue with DR. And you might be wondering, bloating wasn't such a big thing before you were pregnant, and why is bloating such a huge thing after pregnancy? So from what I've learned and the research that I've found, that before pregnancy, your body was, everything else is, it was normal. Like your muscles weren't tight, like your hips weren't tight, your pelvis weren't tight, and you were breathing normally, like, right? But after giving birth, your alignment is sort of out of alignment. Your back is on a C-shaped curve. Your ribs could be flared out. And if you had a C-section, the skins might be stuck together. If you had a vaginal birth, maybe you have some tight hip tightness there. So the pressure in our stomach changed. And what happened is, because there is, have to have pressure, core pressure in our body to keep our spine safe. And those pressure has to go somewhere. So the pressure, there is not much room to go up there in your ribs area because they are flared out. And then there's not much room to go down there because it's tight. You had a C-section, they're stitched together. Those layers weren't gliding together. So those, they are really tight. And then so all the pressure now goes to the weakest point of your body, and which is your core, right? Your belly button region, and all pushes to the front. So that's why it makes you look bigger than you think you are, because now your core pressure is only pushing to the front. There's no room to go to the back neither. You're on a C-shaped curve. So just imagine you have like a band, you have a can of beans, and that can of beans are banded. And so that pressure would have to go somewhere. And if there's a part that is sort of weak in that can, that all that pressure will push forward, just like the belly button, our belly button region. And then so what happens if you're eating food that causes you to bloat, causes to be gassier? That pressure builds up even more and pushes to the weakest point of your body, which is your belly, even more. And that's why you would see a much bigger belly than some moms who have the same diastasis recti gap and depth as you are. And that's the biggest reason. So that's the nutrition touch point on that. And because I also see so many moms in my community have that issue, like some moms have 3 fingers gap, 1 knuckle depth, and the other one has the same sort of profile. Maybe their weight, they are, yes, a bit overweight, but their belly look quite different. It's really because of the food that they were eating, and then maybe whether one had a C-section scar or not, the way they were postured, how their posture was, that really play a major role. And their nutrition for sure, what they're eating, how they're eating, are they eating too much? Really hard to digest kind of food. So in the last couple of while, I had to challenge myself. I'm like, there's no way I really wanted to do something. Was I not disappointed? Of course I was disappointed. Was I happy? I mean, I am really happy where I am at and I feel strong, but I really wanted to see what else I can do to challenge my core, what else I can do to remove the saggy belly without having a surgery. And I will not do a surgery, and not that I hate or anything, but there's no point for me. Appearance wise doesn't bother me too much, but anybody wants to look better, right? So I wanted to look better. I wanted to see what else I can do. I want to show to my clients that I'm trying to improve myself, that there's always more that we want for ourselves. It's for personal development, for personal growth. And I just wanted to find out that answer, right? So I challenged myself. I worked with a coach who is actually a bikini champion prep coach. So she prep her clients to go on stage to compete bikini bodies for female. So like, if anybody can get me hardcore abs, it would be her. Like, I had no intention to go on the stage, but it would be her to help me. So I worked with her. She gave me her exercise program and I worked on it religiously. I also work on the nutrition part. So what I can tell you with the nutrition, it has helped tremendously with the bloat. It has helped a lot with the way it looks. And I think nutrition, you have to be on point if you want it to look good. But I feel like it is not sustainable sometimes to always eat a certain way, to always be mindful, especially if you're a big fooder, food eater like me. It is hard. But I know if I had a program, if I had a goal and I need to be in that season, in that moment, I could do it, definitely. But for long-term wise, it's not healthy. It's not possible to always maintain it like that. So while it was hard, I tried, and you know, with the nutrition part alone, it was fantastic and my belly looked so much better. But it's not to say that when I'm resting, you will see definition. No. So when I'm doing her workouts, and her workouts are great, it makes me lift a ton of weight and it makes me so, so much stronger. I never realized I could lift that much weight before. For example, I was lifting like a 20 pounds, maybe 30 pounds of deadlift. And by the end of the program, I was able to lift almost 80 pounds. Whew! Like even thinking about that, wow, like I did that actually. I was really amazed. And of course, I did traditional, just normal kind of workout. I wasn't really modifying anything. And for doming, if you were worrying, I mean, I still don't a little bit, but as long as it's a soft dome, it doesn't concern me because it's not like pushing out, you're forcing it to come out. So the conclusion I come to it, and at the end of the 2.5 months later, I feel like my belly still look about the same. I feel like when I'm totally relaxed and resting, my belly still look stretched out, it's saggy, it's loose, there's no definition on it. When I'm engaging, yeah, maybe my obliques looks a little bit more defined, but that mid-core region where I really wanted to look better has no effect. It looks the same. Everywhere else looks a lot better though, like my arms, my booties, my legs, but that belly still look about the same. And really, that conclusion is true for me before I even started this program from a year ago, is that just the abdominal profile I have was just beyond repairable. The whole abdominal profile, the muscles layers of just your total core region is just so stretched out. First from the pregnancy, but also from the very first time that I did the workout completely wrong. That gave me a lot of damage and it was just too much for my body to handle. And then going into second pregnancy without healing it first, or without even strengthening it first, without doing any exercise while I was pregnant on the second time. So that did not do any good for me. And the reason why I didn't do anything was because the physio said I don't need to do anything. I wanted to cry because she actually said, oh, there's nothing you can do about this. There was, you would just look the way you are. I mean, don't worry about it. And well, to some degree, yeah, maybe true, but you know, now I know what I know. I really want to tell you, you wanted to stay fit. Try to strengthen your core muscles before you are pregnant again, if possible. I know sometimes it might not happen that way, and that's okay. But if you can, you know, strengthen your body first, and then really try to take one step at a time, work on your foundation before jumping too quickly into that sweat and run and do all of that fun things that keep your heart rates up and all that. And I think that was one of the main missing key that I found out a lot later, is that you have to get your breathing, your alignment, your posture, you know, noticing those symptoms, doming, bulging, those are the things that we need to work on first before you start the workouts or any other programs. So, to answer the questions, how long does it take to heal the diastasis? Well, everybody is different. Everybody is very different. And on top of that, it could also be your C-section scar, whether those muscles were stitching together. On top of that, whether it is genetics, it could be genetics. If your moms, grandmoms have this belly and it's very protruding, it could pass down to you. It could be exercise that you have done, just like how I was. That was just too hard for you. And you were not fit and you have extra weights to have to lose, and maybe you pushed yourself too hard, and maybe you had multiple or triplets pregnancy and that's really stretched out your belly. It's just like the elastic. It does need some restorations. It could be done with having a good nutrition and strengthening, toning it with exercise, but it might never be possible. But I wanted to tell you that we are strong, we are worthy, and we are beautiful. And it's never too late to even start now. Even if you're listening to this, you are 1 year postpartum or 3 years postpartum or heck, 10 years postpartum. It is never too late to work on your muscles. It's never too late to work on your diastasis. It's asking you, it's telling you, you want to work on me, like help me strengthen my core muscles. Anybody can need some strengthening. Your core is the center of your body. At the end of the day, you know, knowing that you tried everything, knowing that you did your best ability that you could and it didn't work, you can honestly say that you try. But I bet that you have gained a lot in many other aspects of your life. Personal growth, being consistent, having that determination, showing your children what is possible if you set your mind to it, showing your children that you are the role model. You say what you say you're going to do. You say you're going to try, even if it doesn't work, at least you tried. And I wanted to send you this message is that don't be discouraged of where you're at right now. I am sure your hard work it doesn't go waste. Even if it doesn't contribute to the desired goal that you want, I am sure that it contributed to so many other aspects of your life, right? Maybe you have built incredible habits. You are having a really good routine with your family now, with your husband. Maybe you're strong enough to go to the gym with your husband. And maybe you're so strong that you can lift your child and having so much fun with them and without back pain and leaking issues. My friends, I hope this episode helped you understand how long it will help you to heal. It is really different for every single body, but you are worthy, you are strong, you are beautiful. That's all I have for you. Thank you so much for tuning in. Today is a long episode, but I hope that you found some good nuggets out of this. And if you wanted to hang out with me on Instagram at BeckyChoi_. BeckyChoi_. And if you wanted to learn how to work with me with my 90-day Tummy Warrior program, you can check me out at www.tummywarrior.com. And I will talk to you next time. Bye-bye.